One of the first questions or challenges that I receive myself when I'm dealing with Muslims is that they claim that Abraham, mm-hmm. Jesus, Moses, yeah. all of the prophets, they are Muslims. Yeah. Even though centuries before Islam, Abraham existed, Moses was yeah. there. They say, how is that the Quran and the Muslim claim
yes.
that these prophets are Muslims?
Yes, even though Muhammad appears, according to the Muslim sources, he appears around the 6th century, because if you take the chronology mm-hmm. given by the Muslim sources, he was born around 570 AD, and he supposedly had an encounter with the angel Gabriel in 610 AD, and that began his prophetic ministry, which lasted about 23 years. Mm-hmm. Even though it starts in the 6th century, 7th century, he's born in 6th century, in 7th century mm-hmm. he has this miraculous visitation by Gabriel. The Quran teaches that the religion that Muhammad proclaimed, Islam, is not something new. He didn't invent it. It's been the religion of all the prophets, mm-hmm. starting even with Adam. Because according to Islamic theology, Adam was a prophet, someone who received instructions from Allah, mm-hmm. and he passed it on to his community. Because the term Islam means submission or surrender. So when you ask a Muslim, what makes a Muslim truly a Muslim? A Muslim is one who submits That's or right. surrenders his will to the one true God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So they go, in that sense, they're all Muslims. Mm-hmm. Because Abraham was one who worshipped the true God of all and desired to seek his will to the one true God. So in that sense, he's a Muslim. Now, where are they getting this from? They're getting it from their own scripture, the Quran, because to them, the same God that sent down the Bible sent down the Quran. And we'll discuss that and demonstrate that the mm-hmm. God of the Quran is not the true God of the Bible. But so that people understand why Muslims believe this, that Adam, Abraham, Isaac, Jesus, even the Quran doesn't have Jesus saying he's a Muslim, it does quote his disciples. And I put quotation, mm-hmm. you know, quotes them in quotation marks, because we do not believe that the Quran contains the actual speeches of the prophets of God. Mm-hmm. We don't believe that these are the words of Jesus, let alone his followers. But with that said, I'm just going to look at several verses from the Quran, and I'll refer to them by the number of the chapter, because there are 114 chapters in the Quran, and each chapter has a name. But so that we don't make this too technical and confusing for the Christians, we'll just mention it by the number. So chapter 3, verse 52 of the Quran. Mm-hmm. Chapter 3, verse 52, we are told the following. When Jesus found unbelief on their part, he said, "Who will be my helpers to the work of God?" Said the disciples, "We are God's helpers." Now, this is supposedly Peter, James, and John. They're all bearing witness. We are God's helpers. In Arabic, the word is Allah. We are the helpers of Allah. We believe in God, Allah, and do thou bear witness. You, Jesus, bear witness. We are Muslims. So according to the Quran, they told Jesus to testify on their behalf. They are Muslims. Now, that's also repeated in chapter 5, verse 111. Mm-hmm. But this is the one that I think is most interesting. Chapter 3 of the Quran, verse 67. Chapter 3, verse 67, we are told, Abraham was not a Jew, nor yet a Christian, but he was true in faith and bowed his will to God's will, which is Islam. Now, more literally, the more literal translation is, he was an upright Muslim. So notice, Abraham wasn't a Jew, he wasn't a Christian, he was an upright Muslim. That's what the Arabic says. Hanif Muslimun. He is an upright Muslim. And in chapter 22, verse 78 of the Quran, we are told that this is the religion of Abraham, your father. 22:78, speaking to the Muslims, addressing the Muslims through Muhammad, says, this is the religion of your father Abraham. So notice, the Quran claims that Abraham is the father of Muhammad, physically and spiritually. Mm-hmm. And we have named you both here and before Muslims. So the Quran says. So the challenge to the Christians is this. What was the religion of Abraham? What was the religion of Jesus? What was the religion of the apostles? They couldn't have been Jews, because the term Jew is an ethnic marker. Mm-hmm. It denotes your ethnicity, your tribe. And Abraham existed before the Israelites came into being. Mm-hmm. So what was his religion? So as a Christian, this happens to be one of the challenges that we have to answer, and not just based on tradition or what we believe. We need mm-hmm. to be able to demonstrate from the scriptures, the Holy Bible, that what we believe is anchored in the Bible, mm-hmm. that is revelation from God. Now, even when you answer the Muslims and you show them from the Bible, they'll still deny it. They'll say, well, your Bible's corrupt, which we'll address. We will put them in a position where they cannot say the Bible's corrupt if they're going to be faithful to the Quran. And we'll talk about that, Lord willing, in a future episode. But what does the Bible say was the religion of at least the followers of Jesus? You don't need to guess. In 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 14 to 16. I'm reading the Modern English Version. It's modernized King James. 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 14 to 16. Now, we believe as Christians, Peter wrote this by inspiration of the Holy Spirit.
That's right.
He wasn't giving us his opinion. He was telling us what God wanted the church to know. So notice what he says in verse 14, the fourth chapter of 1 Peter. If you are reproached because of the name of Christ. Now there he doesn't tell you what the name of Christ is. If you are being attacked, persecuted for the name of Christ, you are blessed because the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. On their part, he is blasphemed. The Lord is blasphemed. But on your part, Christ is glorified. Now, what does it mean to bear the name of Christ? Does it mean calling yourself Muslim or a Jew? Verse 16 tells you. Same chapter, two verses later. Yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, did he say suffer as a Muslim?
No, as a Christian.
If anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God because of it. So right there in our own scriptures, we are told that bearing the name of Christ is to be called, identified as a Christian. Because what is a Christian? A follower of Christ. And that's what the Bible exhorts everyone to be, a follower of the Christ who is Jesus of Nazareth. In fact, in Acts 26, 28 and 29, Paul is trying to convince even the Roman authorities to become a Christian. So Agrippa says to Paul, "You almost persuade me to be a Christian, Paul." Notice what he didn't say. You almost persuade me to be a Jew or a Hindu. No. You've almost got me to the point of becoming a Christian. Now notice what Paul says. Verse 29. I pray to God that not only you, but all who hear me this day might become not only almost, but thoroughly and altogether what I am, except for these chains. Because Paul was in prison. I want you to be a Christian. I want you to be persuaded of being a Christian, a follower of Jesus Christ, as I am. Now that was Acts 26, 28 to 29. So as far as the followers of Jesus are concerned, they're all called Christians. But what about Abraham? What about Isaac? What about Jacob? What about David? What was their religious identity, their label? Well, obviously, Abraham's the father of the Jews, so he could not be a Jew. Well, what about David? He was a Jew because he was from the tribe of Judah, and he lived in the land of Judea. So was he a Jew? Ethnically, yes. Religiously, no. So this is going to probably shock even Christians to hear this. But if you are a Bible-believing Christian, committed to the authority of Scriptures, then the answer to that question to anyone, not just to the Muslim, if a Jew asked me that question, who doesn't believe in Jesus, if a Hindu asked me that question, according to Jesus Christ our Lord, and according to his followers, everyone before him, Adam, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, David, they're all Christians. Now let me prove that to you. First, again, let's define the term Christian. What does Christian mean again?
Christians means a follower of Christ.
Okay. According to the New Testament, all the prophets were inspired by the Spirit to speak of the coming of the Christ. Let's see what our Lord Jesus says. First, in fact, before we go to Jesus, let's go to his followers. John 1, verse 45. And this is found all throughout the Gospels and the letters. Repeated references to the law of Moses and the prophets. The law of Moses and the prophets. What the law and the prophets said about the Christ. Which means that they believe all of the prophets, including Moses who wrote the law, spoke of Jesus. Well, if they spoke of Jesus, because he's the Christ. Jesus is the Christ. So if they spoke of the Christ, they're talking about Jesus. Well, if they all spoke of Christ, that means they all knew about Christ. And that means they were all waiting for Christ. So in that sense, they were Christians. Because they hope for the coming of Christ to save them. John 1, 45, John chapter 1, verse 45. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him of whom Moses in the law as well as the prophets wrote. We have found the one that they all spoke about." Muhammad? No. Buddha? No. Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. See, Moses and them all wrote about him. He's here. He has come to fulfill their promises. Jesus himself in John 5, 45 to 47. John 5, 45 to 47. "Do not think that I shall accuse you to the Father." He's speaking to the unbelieving Jews. He's saying, don't think I'm going to accuse you before the Father. I won't be your judge on the day of judgment. Who's going to be your judge? There is one who accuses you, Moses, in whom you trust. For if you believe Moses, you would believe me, for he wrote of me. Wait, Moses wrote about Jesus. That means Moses knew about Jesus. When I say Jesus, I'm talking about Moses wrote of the coming of the Messiah, the Christ, the anointed one of God who would save Israel and the world. Well, if Moses wrote about the Christ, that means he knew about the Christ and he hoped for the Christ. Mm-hmm. That means he's a Christian.
That's right.
Even before mm-hmm. Jesus was born. Mm-hmm. But if you do not believe his writings, how will you believe my words? Now again, because time is upon us, let me give you an example of Abraham, because that was the question. Because the Quran says Abraham was neither a Jew nor a Christian, but a Muslim. Jesus says, no, Abraham was a Christian. Abraham rejoiced in me, hoped in me, mm-hmm. trusted in me, and he loved me. Now, we're catching this in mid-context. Jesus is having a confrontation with the Jews. And he's questioning their legitimacy to Abraham. He's saying, though you're physically sons of Abraham, you're not truly his sons. Now, why? John 8:39-40. They respond, Abraham is our father. We are descendants of Abraham. Pay attention to the words of our Lord Jesus. Jesus said to them, if you were Abraham's children, by the way, this is John 8:39-40. If you were Abraham's children, you would do the words of Abraham. You would do the works of Abraham. You would do and act like Abraham. Mm-hmm. But now, here's the proof. You have nothing to do with Abraham. Notice his answer. But now you seek to kill me, a man who has told you the truth, which I heard from God. So you're trying to kill me. Abraham did not do this. Here's proof. You have nothing to do with Abraham. Physically, you are his descendants, but spiritually, you have no connection to him. Why? Mm-hmm. You're trying to kill me. Abraham didn't try to do this. Did it sink in? Abraham didn't try to do what?
Killing Jesus.
But how does that make sense? When Abraham had been dead for 2,000 years when Jesus said this, what do you mean Abraham didn't try to kill you? Are you saying that somehow you and Abraham saw each other? Now notice how he concludes the chapter. Mm-hmm. Same chapter, John 8:56-59. Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day. He saw it and was glad. So he answers the question. See, unlike you, you want to kill me? When he saw me, he was happy. So the Jews ask a natural question. Notice their question.
You're not even 50 years old.
Yeah, then Jews said, you're not even 50 years. You've seen Abraham. Now, he could have corrected them if they were wrong. If they misunderstood him, he could have said, you're not getting it. I'm not saying I saw him or that we saw each other face to face. I'm talking about God revealed to him my coming. Even though God did that, Jesus says it's more than that. Not only did God reveal to him my coming, I actually saw him and he saw me. Because then in 58 he says, Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was born, I am. So here's the answer. Don't let my physical appearance mislead you. I'm much older than 50. In fact, I'm older than your father Abraham. I was there before your father came into being. Mm-hmm. I was already in existence. Mm-hmm. And I remain in existence perpetually because unlike Abraham, who was created, I am eternal. Mm-hmm. Yes, I saw him, he saw me. And then their reaction is, then they took up stones to throw at him, but Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple. Going through their midst, he passed by. So according to Jesus, Abraham saw me, I saw him. He was happy to see me. He trusted in me. He hoped in me. Mm-hmm. That makes him a Christian. For the sake of time, the final example. Mm-hmm. What about David? Mark 12:35-37. Now note, for the Christian, this is gospel truth. For the Christian, if Jesus says it, that's it. End of story. We cannot have an answer other than Jesus. If Jesus is saying, all the prophets hoped in my coming, all the prophets trusted in me, all the prophets believed in me, mm-hmm. then the answer is they were Christian. I'm not saying they knew the term, but that's what they were. Because mm-hmm. what is a Christian? A follower of Christ. Right. They were not a follower of Allah, and they did not wait for the coming of Muhammad. They were not Muslims. Now notice David. Mark 12:35-37. While Jesus taught in the temple, he said, how can the scribes say that Christ is a son of David, that he's a mere human son of David? David himself, pay attention, speaking by the Holy Spirit. So who inspired David to know this? Mm-hmm. The Holy Spirit. David himself, speaking by the Holy Spirit, declared, the Lord, Jehovah, said to my Lord, so there are two here, the Lord speaking to someone else that David acknowledges as his Lord. My Lord. The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put your enemies under your foot. David himself calls the Messiah, the Christ, Lord. How then is he a son? And the large crowd heard him gladly. So Jesus says, the Holy Spirit revealed to David that I, the Christ, happened to be his Lord. And he confessed me as his Lord in Psalm 110:1. Now the challenge is, well, if he's a son of David, because Messiah is a son of David, then he can't be his Lord unless he's more than a human son. And that was his point. Though the Messiah is a human son of David, he's much more than human. He's also David's Lord and therefore his God. So Jesus was trying to show from this that David himself knew by the Spirit the Messiah is human and divine. As God, he's David's Lord. As man, he's David's son. So according to Jesus, even David was a Christian who worshiped Jesus, the Messiah, as his Lord. Right. End of story.
Thank you, brother. I have a question, actually. Yes. Many organizations, many Christian churches in the West, they tell their workers, their missionaries to the Muslim world, or the people that they deal with, Muslims, evangelizing, they tell them not to say you are a Christian.
Okay.
Just tell them that I am the follower of Isa ibn al-Maryam, or I'm the follower of the prophet Isa. When clearly from the scriptures we're called Christians,
yes,
followers of yes. Christ, he's our Lord, he's our Savior, how then some of these doctrines has entered to these churches?
Because, and again, I don't want to attack people or question motives. Their motives are sincere in that they're hoping to remove as many obstacles to the gospel so that Muslims can accept the gospel. However, the way they're going about it, they're not only watering down the gospel, and therefore they have no gospel to offer and there's no power, but the end result of all of this time spent hasn't produced a harvest of Muslims who are in love with Jesus and sold out for the gospel of Christ. So though their intention is good, let's remove all these barriers and misunderstanding. Because when you say Christian to a Muslim, they're going to associate, oh, America and its immorality. That's what they say.
Hollywood.
Yeah, instead of clarifying that's not a Christian, they say, well, let's just remove the name whatsoever. Not only does that water down the gospel, and therefore anytime you water down the gospel, you won't be operating in the power of the Holy Spirit, and so you won't see genuine results from the Spirit, which is why this method of evangelism hasn't produced a large harvest of truly born-again, Spirit-filled Muslims. So my advice to these Christians is what Peter said, 1 Peter 4:16. Let me repeat it. Peter's inspired by the Holy Spirit. You don't become a more spiritual Christian than Peter. You can't tell me Peter was wrong and you're right. He was inspired by the Spirit, and he knew Jesus. If anyone knew what it was to walk in the Spirit, it's him. If he didn't, there's no hope for any of us. 1 Peter 4:16. Let me repeat the inspired words of the apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ. Yet if anyone suffers as a follower of Christ, no. As a Christian, he uses the word Christian. Christianos in the Greek. Christianos. Let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God because of it. So Peter tells me, don't be ashamed that you call yourself a Christian. But they're telling me, be ashamed, be embarrassed. So who should I follow? The one that that was inspired by the Spirit, whom the Spirit told him to write, exhort Christians, don't be ashamed that you call yourself a Christian? Or these other individuals who come 2,000 years after Peter, whose fruit, if you see the fruit of their evangelism, it's pretty bad. Because they haven't produced the harvest of Spirit-filled, on fire, born-again
Muslim
actually, converts.
I have met families that they have gone to the Middle East, to the Muslim countries, and they went to the mosque, prayed just like Muslims, in the name of just being just like them, and contextualize the whole message.
Perversion.
And they have gone to the mosques and pray with Muslims, and to build bridges, and they have said to the Muslim that we are the followers of Isa ibn al-Maryam or the Prophet Jesus.
He's the son of Mary,
and I personally know families that after a while, those missionaries that they were sponsored by our churches went there and have converted to Islam.
Yes, exactly. Because they are not walking in the power of the Holy Spirit. They're not energized by the Spirit. They're not in obedience to the Spirit. So the Lord removes his hand of protection, and then the demonic influence of Islam has its way with them. Because the Holy Spirit will not honor any method that's contrary to the methods he's prescribed in Scripture. You don't know more than the Spirit, and you don't do a better job of the Holy Spirit. That's right. The Holy Spirit says, say you're Christian. So my response would be, just because people must understand the term, doesn't mean I don't use the term. I then explain its true meaning and significance and remove that misunderstanding. Mm-hmm. Just like a Muslim won't stop calling himself a Muslim because ISIS claimed to be Muslim who murder people. Mm-hmm. You'll never hear a Muslim saying, oh, no, 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 I'm a follower of Muhammad. I don't want you calling me a Muslim because that name has been hijacked. They'll tell you, no, I'm a Muslim. They're not Muslims. That's right. They have mm-hmm. hijacked the name, misrepresenting Islam. I'm a Muslim. Why can't we do the same? Show more zeal and honor for the word of God and for the name Christian than Muslims do for their false god and false prophet.
And we're commanded to trust the Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah.
He'll bring the conviction.
Hallelujah.
And if we preach the gospel, we will see the result.
Amen.